to Christian. Christian, go ahead.
Thank you so much, Willem, and thank you all for facilitating this session. We have a huge group of co-authors and co-presenters here. That's why we will directly jump into it. You can find everything already on the Connect platform, the abstract that was peer-reviewed and published, as well as our presentation that I'm going now to present. However, it will not be a presentation, as you will see, but simply an invitation for discussion. That's why let's have a look how it will evolve, and we would be very happy to use these 20 minutes here for broadest discussion here. You will have the slides, of course, with the Creative Commons license, and you have already the article for your download. You can see that we are focusing two very prominent topics, open education, open science, and we would like to discuss with you how we can strengthen the global education and learning, not only during, but also after the COVID-19 outbreak. That's why we have made four assumptions, and I will go to present the very first assumption, and my co-authors will then take over and present assumption 2, 3, and 4. And the first assumption is open education and open science can facilitate new learning opportunities. We strongly believe that there is also a big chance now due to COVID-19 outbreaks that open education and open science can facilitate changes in global learning and education towards individual key competence development for self-related learning and living. That is our first assumption. The second one, Carol, are you ready to present the second one, please?
Sure, and you have it up here on the screen, so it's easy enough for people to also read. The idea that open education and open science can foster communication and collaboration, I think is really important, you know, especially in online systems, using social media, trying to use social media to actually increase media literacy and make facts more transparent, critical thinking, really fighting against fake news and conspiracy theories that are out there. And I think what we're thinking is that the opportunity that COVID brings is that more people are in online spaces and reliant on online. And how do we take and turn that conversation that so that we can actually increase literacy and factual information as opposed to it being the other way around?
Thanks, Karen. And are you ready, Aras, to present assumption number 3?
Yes, I am ready. Our third assumption is that open education and open science can boost innovation by facilitating collaborations in finding solutions like medicines for COVID-19 through greater availability and accessibility of publicly funded scientific research outputs.
Thank you, Aras. And actually, assumption number 4 should be presented by John. Are you here? Because I cannot see faces here. If not, I'd like to ask you, Chrissy, to jump in and to present assumption 4, if you are ready.
That's fine. I'm going to jump in. Christian, hello, everybody. So our fourth assumption is about open education, open sciences to strengthen democracy and resilience within our global society by building responsible citizens, as well as reliability and trust in our local and regional community. So this is a call for action to be active and proactive in what is happening around the world and work with others. Thank you.
Thank you, Chrissy, in particular for that last minute uptake. We could now talk for hours here, but we'd like to discuss with you. That's why, first of all, have a look. This is a link to an online board where you can always present your ideas related to the four assumptions, and please use it and simply click on the link and pin your ideas, your questions and your thoughts to the four assumptions on the online board. While you're doing that, we'd like also you to go to this website here. This is a Mentimeter for online voting. And we have now two questions for you. And I'd like also to go directly here to that. If I could find it here. Yeah, go away. Yeah. And here you can now start with your voting. How much do you agree with all the four assumptions? Please use this one, the link. I hope you can.
Christian, I have shared the link in the chat, so it should be fine.
Okay, great. Let's have a look if somebody is already voting on it.
Might need to quickly review the assumptions.
Yeah, I was thinking the same.
Okay, again, assumption number one. Assumption two. Assumption three. And assumption four. And here we have first votes on that. Okay. That works. Great.
There are two of them competing. looks like politics a bit.
Yeah. You have to vote for an assumption as opposed to choose each one. Is that how that's set up?
Okay, 11. You have already 11. Okay, great. Then let's go back. And now the question is, which assumption do you want to discuss in the remaining 10 minutes or 12? Okay, I think we can take that now as the voting here towards assumption number one. Thank you so much for that. And having said that, I have to get back here again. And now the floor is yours. We have taken assumption number one. I will simply copy it again into the chat room. What are your thoughts? What are your questions or comments here related to assumption number one? Thank you, Chrissy.
Christian, they can only respond via the chat, so.
Yes, as well as via Twitter, as we have also invited everybody to join via Twitter.
And the other board where they can post notes, the Scrumbler.
Yep.
Okay. And I think assumption one was about facilitating new learning opportunities.
Yeah.
It might be useful if colleagues share some examples from practice, from their own, or from others in their institution, or more widely, perhaps what they have seen that has been created and shared more widely in the last few months.
Okay, thank you, Fabio, for your agreement and confirmation. Oh, this is a nice one.
There's a question, Christian.
Yeah, I noted the question from Vanessa now. We believe that open science should not only be a topic to be taught or to be addressed in education in schools, but this is also an individual perspective that you also not only feel, but also act like an open scientist, as well as open science as a discipline, so-called, or a concept that is forcing everybody to not only publish everything online, but to follow also the principles of open science is also a major step towards new educational settings, meaning that also pupils can already explore how the principles of open science are changing the way to discuss as well as to present learning outcomes.
And I think we have a comment in the chat that I actually agree with. We've been thinking about from Su Ming Ku, who says, while I agree that open is really valuable for individual knowledge acquisition and learning, I think this overemphasis on individualization is potentially corrosive to the collective and shared public benefit of open science. And I think that's true, that when we think about like what are the benefits of open science to people at large, how is it that we work with our goals in mind being the collective and not anyone's individual scientific superstarness or however we might frame that. And I agree that that's a really important point and the way that we shape our institutions so that we're rewarded for the ways in which we contribute to a larger collective.
Yeah, and Fabio is also highlighting that there is a need for minimal initial support, and afterwards it will start by itself. And I also agree with that, at least some guidance is needed in the beginning. The following question by Johanna is more challenging about how QR codes and tracking apps can also be seen critically in a way that they have also to fulfill requirements by the management.
I would like to add something. You know, when I look at the Joanna's question, you know, I see we have the same concerns with open education, like surviving society. I mean, okay, there is an intention, but who collects data, how they will use that, I think it is open to discussion. Another thing I want to tell is, it's a bit beyond our discussion, but when we talk about open education and open science, I just think who owns the knowledge, because now some scientists found a vaccine in Germany and governments are bargaining, to buy the vaccine before the other countries. I mean, you know, even in the middle of a global crisis, there are interesting and, to me, unethical discussions on that side. So I think, you know, open science and also open education should always go to the core values, and from my perspective, it is collaboration and sharing.
Indeed, and it is also one of the core sustainable development goals, as we all know. And I believe that focus on openness can maybe change the current situation that some major business companies are dictating what is happening in online communication. And here we have maybe the chance that we can not avoid tracking apps, but we could use them through making everything openly and transparent, that we also encourage as well as convince others how it is needed that everything is openly shared towards common goals, towards learning as a human right, and towards a global citizenship that is facilitating such open education and open science, of course, always with quality.
And there's an interesting discussion also going on in the chat about the focus on the individual versus the society. Sometimes that's a little confounded too, like the ways in which individuals are benefited. So for example, if everyone has better health, you know, if I'm healthier, that helps me as an individual, but it actually helps the society because there's less public cost for medical costs. And so everyone else benefits too. And so the ways in which people look at individual versus public benefit can be, you know, a little bit overly simplified, whereas there's a lot of complicated interaction between the two.
There was a question about the obstacles in front of the open education and open science. I think, you know, this is another question to answer that question. Who benefits from open science and who makes profit from open science? If we can find the answer for these questions, probably we will make a lot of progress. You know, even in open education, you know, there are some initiatives who tries to make profit from education, that many educators like us, that's why we defend open science, to balance the power distribution all around the world. Similarly, you know, for open science, there is a global problem. Who benefits from open science and who makes profit?
Yes. We have 2 minutes left.
Yeah, thank you, Willem, for the reminder. And yeah, there are much more questions here, but I believe this is a very good starting point to find out how open education and open science can support each other, not only in the fields of higher education, not only in the regions of Europe or America or Asia, but also with a global focus, also in the countries that are not that well developed and who are struggling with a very simple means related to open education and open science. Having said that, we have prepared a very last question for you, also again in Mentimeter, just to find out whether there was a kind of change in your mind during that. And I'd like to show it right now, because otherwise time is running out. And here we have now, first, I have to show you the final vote on the assumptions here. This is another Mentimeter voting. We're curious whether you have changed your opinions about the four assumptions during the last 20 minutes. I hope that you can simply copy and paste that into the chat here. And then let's have a look. Can you see it?
Maybe in 20 minutes, maybe a little short for
Yes,
having
of
fully
course.
considered all this. But I wanted to remind people that the Scrambler board is an opportunity for people to add additional thoughts even after this session is over. Mm-hmm. And we can continue to collect ideas.
Okay. And also the voting will still be open for you. And yeah, I think time is over. Thank you so much for the lively discussion. And we are looking forward also to continue our discussion about how to combine open education and open science. We are currently working on a report from different regions and countries all over the world. If you're interested in that, please do not hesitate to contact us, and we are happy also to collaborate with you in the future. Thank you so much for your attention and looking forward to our future collaboration. See you.
Thank you very much, Christian, Karen, Chrissy, Aras, and Fabio.